link directly to our Key Stage 3 curriculum. And both of you are from United Learning. Some of this will feel familiar, but actually it's still hopefully made you think about something. And we're always trying to develop how we're thinking about formative assessment, what it tells us about what students know and what they don't know. But I'm going to pass over to Matthew, but I'll introduce him then, and then he's going to come back to me for the final session. Talk about something slightly different, but really hitting what Colin was talking about, really, which is about accountability. You know, what are students doing? How do we know they're doing it? How can we support them best in the build-up to the exams? So I believe we have got a really good collaborative approach to curriculum assessment across the network. We've got a common curriculum all the way from year 7 up to year 11, which means we can share assessments, we can share resources, we can then share data as well. We've got CPD, which comes in various forms, so I guess a new form of CPD from my perspective as well. I work probably, well, all the way from Carlisle down to Bournemouth, so that's about sort of 32 to 35 schools at the moment, and just getting in regularly enough is just not possible. And those kind of messages that you want schools to hear day in, day out, we're trying to find more innovative ways of getting that message across. So a lot of CPD is going on at the moment to try and create some better use of like technology to support that. And then sharing best practices is effectively everything. How do you do that? We have regular head of department meetings, but that's only at that level. So then how does that filter down into departments? And that, I think, is still an area for improvement, because essentially the results are going to come from the whole cohort now. So the ULP Stage 3 curriculum, just to give a brief overview about the key principles, fewer things in more depth, and that is easier said than done because the maths, well, curriculum is so content heavy. You've still got to cover it all, but what we're trying to do is to avoid a spiral curriculum by slowing it down and building in regular formative assessment to support retention of knowledge. That's the main goal, really. And it's just still a work in progress. And we classify it into something called KPIs, which you've probably heard of, so key performance indicators. We never call it that now, we just say KPIs. Effectively in maths, it works out quite nicely. It's effectively topics. So we can create things like topic tests for each KPI. So it supports our thinking quite well. And we base it on the maths route approach. And I should put that in inverted commas, because if we ask every single person here to define that, it's actually really difficult. And we aren't a set of schools in Singapore. We can't have that approach because culturally it's so different. But we can take things slower and go into more depth. And I believe we should be stretching students in Key Stage 3 by going deeper in the topic as opposed to chucking in GCSE topics, thinking that we're stretching them in that way, but we're not. The way to stretch students is to actually think about what you're doing with them and then say, what if? How can I make this topic even more tricky? What are the subtle differences that if they don't see it now, and then they see it in the exam, they're going to fall flat on their face? That, for me, is stretch, and whether that's mastery or not, I don't know, but I don't think we'll ever have a single definition. Closing gaps is something we talk about in maths all the time. We always say, oh, students just forget everything. It's actually not fair, because as would we if we were learning new content and not having the opportunity to practice it. The most important thing is putting stuff in place to help them remember all the content. And again, I'm not going to talk about summative assessment because it's there, it will always be there, and Daisy spoke really well about it today, about the difficulties around comparable data. The key really is formative assessment in Stage 3, in preparing for GCSE. So just kind of talking about formative assessment, the key thing is exemplification. Actually sharing with teachers what a topic looks like, that is key. So how do you best prepare students? Well, if you know what the end goal can look like, then you can step back and then prepare for that. And there's lots of ways we can do this. I'm going to talk about a few things, particularly fluency, which it's effectively AO1, but I'm calling it fluency, how to be fluent in maths. We're going to talk about problem solving a little bit, but that is the next layer. If you haven't got fluency, problem solving and reasoning is kind of out of the window. And then how to repair gaps in knowledge. These are key things which need exemplifying in curriculums. So how do you achieve it? Well, what do students know? It's always step one, and we can't assume anything. We can't take the starting point as something where we think they should be, because actually even if the starting point from Key Stage 2 is a very able student, over the summer that knowledge could have just disappeared. We don't know what their prep was up until that sat exam. What do they not know? that one is the most important question. Basically, how do you know is the toughest bit. It's how you actually dig deep and find out what to do and don't know. It's really difficult. Mini whiteboards are a fantastic way of finding out a lot of information about what you need to do and don't know. But in terms of formal procedures, like we have formal KPI tests, we call them, or knowledge tests. These form part of our exemplification package. We expect teachers to look at these formative assessments before they start delivery of a topic, just to go, okay, that's what it could look like. Instead of kind of falling into like old habits of teaching just fluency in a kind of a basic way, we use these as a tool for teaching effectively. And then students sit these formative tests. They form part of a very rigorous process in schools on build up to a summative assessment. And in an ideal world, they would master fluency and then be able to apply it in problem solving and reasoning. So they roughly have like a 50-50 split on addressing those two things. If they've got the fluency, it's really then quite easy to build the skills needed for problem solving and reasoning. And that will take time and will always be difficult because the biggest form of problem solving and reasoning, as you know, is students don't know what the question is asking them. They don't know what the maths is. It's that problem about extracting the maths out of all these words. So the big focus at the moment is fluency, but with a twist. So how often do students see questions which bring in loads of different content together? And even something like a half plus 0.2, quarter plus 0.2, well, it's testing so many different things. How would they approach it? Would they convert from decimal to fraction? It tells you so much. Put it on an interactive mini whiteboard, get students to hold up what they would do, tell you a massive amount about their prerequisite knowledge, about fraction addition, decimal addition, whatever it will be. This one here, I mean, we teach linear equations. It's like a topic which probably we all look forward to teaching. I know it's my favourite thing to teach algebra. As a teacher, 3 or 4 years ago, as head of maths, I was not teaching that question. I was not using that question in lessons. I would be a much better teacher now if I went back in as head of department through seeing, I think, all the pitfalls the students fall into when they get into that exam. They need to see the unknown. And that tests those things. So do they know the square roots? That could have been something you taught 2 months ago that they found dead easy at the time. And we said, oh yeah, they've mastered it. But did they really? You only know that when you bring it back in again, and test, kind of bring it back in subtle ways to test if they know. Something like this, which kind of is a nightmare. If we saw that on exam paper in the summer, we'd kind of hold our head in our hands. But we shouldn't be doing that because students should be seeing stuff like this so they don't have those surprises. So the 2x minus 1 equals 10 type scenario is not happening anymore. This could be more common. So if they can do this, you hope that they can prepare for that exam a bit better. And that's, a lovely question from diagnostic questions. So many things could come out of that. If you put that on a mini whiteboard, you'd probably really struggle with it. But we may have kind of fallen back in a false sense of security and said, well, I've taught them linear equations, I've taught them like standard linear equation questions, and they were fine at it. But did we put some fractions in there? Did we make it look a bit nasty? And then the other thing that we focus on at the moment is multiple choice questions, which are just such an easy diagnostic tool to use in the classroom. So at the start of every topic that we do, every KPI, we have a diagnostic multiple choice test. Just to kind of pick out where there's misconceptions about before you start teaching the topic. And so it's a really obviously nice question, probably you use this from Craig Barton. Some really nice questions there. So we talk about exemplification. There's loads of amazing resources to use which exemplify some interesting maths questions. One of my favourite websites is actually a blog, which is Conception of the Good, by Naveen Rizvi. So some of the questions on here are really nice, and actually just kind of take us out of our comfort zone a little bit. And if you are doing questions like that, it's great. But from what I'm seeing, even within our schools, and we're really, really promoting this still isn't happening, because it's difficult to do that in lessons, because it will be hard for students. Some really nice questions. I really suggest you look at that blog if you've not had a look at it before. And Donna Stewart has just so many nice resources on there, like pages and pages of amazing questions. We put these in our exemplification resources because we want staff, teachers to be using them for extension. So when I have the discussion with staff about, oh, the scheme of work is too easy for our students this half term, I say, okay, what if you had a look at these type of questions? Have you done that? And most of the time I sit back and go, oh yeah, okay, that's what it could look like. And then stretch students within a topic. And further resources, I mean, put your hand up if you've got this book. Yeah. So I think that every single maths teacher should be given this book. I think it should be like the textbook of a department. And a lot of people I've spoken to about this book recently are saying actually they think that all teachers across all subjects should read this book, even though it's just about maths. But actually the concepts which are talked about in this book are just simple, yet really, really effective. And Craig Barton, for me, has made me rethink so many different things, particularly the approach to problem solving, which if you listen to his blog, was just really, it was just fantastic. And of course, diagnostic questions, he's a brain behind that. It's just, you know, another great thing from him. So, just in summary, all that leads to this rigorous process, which every single half term we have a summative assessment. For me, that is the least important part of our curriculum, even though it seemed to be as important. You know, how do we know where students are they on age-related expectations or not? It's everything that builds up to that. They can't cope in that summative assessment situation unless they've had all the supporting tools along the way. And our assessments are set up to test fluency and problem-solving reason, very intentional, Section A, 50%, Section B, 50%. And typically students do find Section B far more difficult. I probably haven't got time really for questions, but if there's anything, just anything specific, you can definitely ask a question now, or at the end we can perhaps have a few questions at the very end after Matthew and I have spoken again. So I think I'll pass on to Matthew in that light. Matthew is the head of department at our academies down in Bournemouth, Glenmore and Winton Academies. Matthew's going to talk to you about the results that they've achieved over the last few years. Absolutely phenomenal, I think, is a way of summarising it. Matthew is a fairly new head of department, but I would say he is one of the strongest head of departments in our network, by far. Very innovative, very structured, and teaching and learning about it's just key in the department, and it's very effective. So I've asked Matthew to share something with you today, which I'm sharing with schools at the moment, which is how to get a good start to the first 10 minutes of your lesson, which is a big focus on my business to schools. First 10 minutes, very important, they add up across the week, across the year. Maybe we can cut out Saturday morning intervention if we get the first 10 minutes right.
Thank you very much in kind words. Everything that I talk about is either kind of evolved from things we've stolen from other schools, completely copied from what I've seen online and transplanted into a lesson, or something that's kind of a bit of a mismatch of the two, really. I think it says something about teaching that memory and remembering things has been spoken about in every minute of this session today, and that's certainly something that I didn't get in my training and wasn't something in the first couple of years of teaching that I heard talked about a lot, and I think reflects very well on the teaching profession this evening. Just to kind of set up schools really where I work, Glenmore Winton Academies, we as a school have been on quite an improvement journey, and several years ago the schools were in quite a poor state and improved rapidly over that time, focusing on behaviour and then focusing more on exam results, and kind of the two together, and quite a big improvement journey certainly over the last 5 or 6 years. I joined about 2.5 years ago to teach maths, and have developed a huge amount and learned a huge amount since being there. We are co-located academies, so we are an all-boys school and an all-girls school. If you arrive at the school, it looks just like any other. There are two separate buildings joined by a canteen, and it used to be the boys all went in the canteen, and then the girls all went in the canteen separately, and then they kind of put all that together. So officially we're two separate schools, but you wouldn't see it if you came to visit. We work in an area where there are grammar schools, so we have kind of a roughly kind of 80% that isn't really talked about very often. It's not in any way seen as an excuse, but gives a bit of background really to our students and a bit of background to the results. Last year our progress rate for school was very, very strong. Girls performing slightly better than the boys. And what I'm most proud of and most pleased with were the maths results. My first set of results was the head of department. I felt incredibly lucky on results day, seeing the students absolutely elated with their grades, and something we're incredibly proud of. A lot of what that is down to the improvement of the school, but there's a few kind of math specific things that we do that I want to mention that hopefully you'll be able to take away and use or adapt in some way for your schools. So it's been mentioned a little bit, but something I found from visiting other UL schools and from talking to anyone that works for United Learning or works in a United Learning school is a focus on behaviour being absolutely the most important thing. So it's something I talk to my department about a lot, so that we don't have to talk about it a lot. By being obsessive about behaviour and being obsessive about the attitude of the kids and how warm and friendly we are to them, that hopefully should deal with a lot of the behaviour problems that go on in other schools and certainly other schools that I've seen. We use rank order to make sure students are very motivated for assessments and a few other things kind of related to that. But despite all of that, and despite the results, my students still forget things. Your students still forget things, and I find that an absolute injustice, and I really get frustrated by it. And like Colin, my first lessons were terrible, and students, it was like they'd walked out the door and it just disappeared completely. And I really felt a failure as a teacher, and then I looked at other teachers who I thought were quite good, and their kids forgot everything as well. And then when I moved to Glenmore and Winton, I thought, God, some really good teachers here, and their kids were still forgetting things. And I thought back to one of my best teachers when I was at school, Mr. Freer, who really motivated me to study economics, which is when I went on to study at university. And something he did from GCSE, every lesson, right to the end of our A levels, was to set a 10 question quiz that he'd completely make up on the spot. Or at least we thought we did anyway, we may not have done, but he'd just make up 10 questions and we'd all sit down quite furiously, it was dead silent. And I thought, I need something like that. So I experimented with some quiz questions. I tried planning the topics, and it kind of didn't quite work. We'd write them all up on the board, it took too long. So I started experimenting with printing them. And then I saw one of our excellent teachers, who's now gone to be a head teacher, using something called the starter map. I thought, this is quite intriguing. And I kind of looked into it a little bit more. Alongside the starter maps, which I'm going to talk about, we used Hegarty Maths a huge amount. We're very proud to be fourth and ninth for our hours in the country for Hegarty Maths, and we're pushing to be top. We also used the quizzes, and I believe Faye's going to talk about in a bit more detail, or has spoken about already, and may talk a bit more about. We did starter maths, and what I saw in Mr. Nash's classroom was kids walk in and be absolutely silent, absolutely committed to getting things right, and absolutely committed to not forgetting things. Now, we're very aware, oh, we're doing this because we don't want to forget what's going on in the classroom. And Mr. Nash, if anyone had been to see him, he creates a bit of a cult around him, and his kids worshipped him. And we do miss him in that regard, but they worshipped almost the starter map, and they couldn't deal with not having the routine of a starter map, there's a cover lesson, or there's anything different with that. And when I spoke with Mr. Nash about it a bit more, and I thought about my own hands in having a start to the lesson, I wanted to get down that students remembered everything we gave them, everything that we delivered, assuming that they understood it very well in the lesson. I didn't want any of them to forget it. But it also ticked off a couple of things that Colin mentioned, and it's been mentioned earlier about a calm and purposeful start to the lesson, kids working very hard and just working in a productive way to start off their lesson. Whether that lesson's 40 minutes, 50 minutes, 100 minutes, however long your lessons are, those first few minutes have been so valuable there. And this is what it's kind of evolved to, and this is the starter map that we use. It is a blend of fluency questions, work on sometimes kind of more involved fluency questions, moving into problems to have a go at, heavily based around topics that students make errors with. So anything to do with negative numbers, anything to do with algebraic manipulation, anything to do with decimals, anything to do with fractions, these kind of common things that students need to know to understand lots of topics, we put in there as much as we can. I delivered that on Monday to my Year 11s, and it's based heavily on what we've done in the last 6 months, roughly, since teaching them from September, and what I expect them to know. These four topics have been flagged in my quiz that I've done in the previous couple of weeks as things that students were struggling with. And I overheard a couple of people talking about what do we do when students get things wrong, how do we remedy them? And that's one of the ways we close the gap, is very much being conscious of what mistakes are people making, particularly when you start them at, and then they can go on from there. We always print them and always put harder problem on the back. Now, it might not be significantly harder, it might be just a problem, it might be something that requires a bit of reasoning, but the point of the start of that is that it's in being printed, which is where I kind of differ really from what Colin was talking about. You can either hand that to students at the door, absolutely dominate the kind of environment as they walk in. You can have it on desks already. It's very easy to check out out from the column and the students pass back where they're in, or other things like that. And it's a very enjoyable thing to just be given a piece of paper and fill it with numbers. I certainly find that enjoyable, I'm sure you maths teachers do, but just being able to fill it with numbers and being able to get so much of that correct and being able to get so much of the work in there for that question when a month ago they didn't really remember how to find the area of a circle. After doing similar questions to that two or three times since, there's a huge amount more confidence that comes with it. So we always print them for every lesson. We've got about 1,500, 1,600 students at our school, so you know, there's a lot of printing that goes with that, but I'd absolutely recommend that, and I'd absolutely push your leadership for printing if you don't have the budget for it, and it's something very, very important. We have 75-minute lessons, so we spend around 10 to 15 minutes working on that. I say silent work, but it's not quite silent. It's usually the odd bit of discussion, a bit of prompting. Occasionally there's a bit of discussion that comes out of it, but that's kind of roughly the time that we spend working on it. The feedback is then led by students or teachers, and by led, really the teacher controls the room and controls what goes on, but you might ask a student to explain how they found their answer and back to someone else, how did you do it, and kind of talk through what the correct responses are. We always use a visualiser for that, and for those of you that don't have visualisers, I would encourage you to spend money when you buy a visualiser. I've seen really poor quality visualisers and use them in classrooms that have got really poor quality smart boards. So I really encourage you to spend as much as you can afford if you're going to use them. And we use a visualiser, have the start map there, and you can write all over it as the students are doing it. Very similar to writing on a smart board, except you can pull student work up and show it in a much more effective way. I know there's much debate in schools around whether you use green, red, purple, pink, black even, maybe, or blue pen. We use green pen as kind of the marking pen in school, and we ensure that when students are going through their feedback, to keep them accountable for their effort, they put green pen on in every box. So you're either ticking each line if you've got each line correct, if you've expanded three pairs of brackets and you're going through each little bit of it, and it's a big long thing, you're ticking each bit that's correct, and you're circling the bits that are wrong, and that really supports them next time you get it right when you give them a similar question, because they've got that detailed feedback written down. And from a planning point of view, one thing that we've learned over the time of using Starter Maths is that it makes sense to plan them in kind of a week's worth or longer if you want to kind of roughly plan topics, whilst also being responsive to things that are coming up in the classroom and the difficulties that are coming with it. I wouldn't recommend doing it one at a time, because it's going to feel like it's going to take you ages, and you're really going to hate doing it, and it's not going to be that productive. So we plan it in a kind of a ream, generally using PowerPoint. We find that quite easy to put them all on, to print them, because you can see so many slides so easily in a way that with Word it's just not quite as easy. In terms of where we get things from, in my starter map, I only actually wrote those questions. Everything else is stolen, and at the letters. But everything else is stolen or kind of copied from somewhere else. So we use Mr. Carter Maths for some. It's a great website. It randomises questions, and we use that and kind of snip out some of the questions from there. textbooks. We've got old copies of the David Rayner textbook, which is top class, but we just don't have enough of them really. So we bought the updated edition, you can access online, and again, we just snip bits out of that. In terms of the problems, which I'd say is harder to create yourself because they take so long, there's a list there of places to go to. Don Stewart would absolutely be a top place to visit. The White Rose resources on the TES, I think, are a great starting point for discussions about problems to solve, and certainly help you when we're teaching the first kind of GCSE topics, or teaching ratio in a new way, and things like that, gave me an idea of the level of depth. And I'd really encourage using the snipping tool to get those and copy those across, and it does make things a little bit easier and less strenuous from a time point of view. So at that point,
who may be struggling to find an effective way to start lessons or to build on the kind of knowledge that they've been learning recently. So it's simplistic, but it's very, very effective, and having seen it in action in various forms, actually, Glenmore Winton Academies, but also at Totteridge Academy, kind of like do now kind of sheets. I know that these are all being used in different forms, but yeah, it's just a nice way to kind of start a lesson, help students wise. So I'm just going to shift the focus a little bit to talk about key stage four strategies. I probably feel like my head is in year 11 nearly all the time in this role, and yet I try to step out of it and think about key stage three as much as possible, because a lot of the stuff we're doing in year 11 I think could have been addressed much, much further down, but we are having to, I guess, address what's happening here and now in year 11 and deal with that, as well as keeping our eye on what's happened previously. So just again, about sharing best practice, the big focus of what we do in Unite Learning is to share strategies which are used across our schools which we think work well. One of these are fluency tests, which formalise effectively what the starter mats are doing. So that could be a formal test once a week or a formal test once a fortnight. So it actually puts students into more of a, it's quite still low stakes, but it really actually forces them to retrieve that knowledge that they've been practising every day. I'll talk about that in more detail. A pre-seen mock, a version which we've adapted from, I guess, like a walking, talking mock, but with a twist. Common questions in the GCSE, those overlap questions between foundation and higher, how are you using them? How can they be used to support students in terms of top-end foundation, the bread and butter of the higher? And structured group work, which if I ever work with students in schools, and of course I don't really know the students that well, I'll always do a group work model, which I used previously in Burns and Davis Academy, with the teachers I used to work with. It was modelled to me, and I've never used anything else since when working with students from a large cohort. I'm not going to go into that model in detail, because actually it would need modelling effectively. But it's basically group work which holds students to account in terms of how they're engaging in the work during that activity. And the only twist on it is they rotate at some point during that activity to teach other students what they've learned. So it kind of puts pressure on them a bit to engage, whereas group work can sometimes feel like we're not 100% sure if all students are there. But the most important thing, really, is how all this leads to student accountability. Now that's a bit I want to focus on in this session, and kind of go back to bits of what Colin was saying, really. We all have all these strategies that we're using with year 11 and all the extra intervention that we put in place for them, whether that's after school, if it's a Saturday, which I'm not that keen on, or half term, still not that keen on, unless we're going back to say, what are we doing and how is it affecting students? And the top of that list, top of all the strategies should be lesson time and what is happening during that lesson time. And secondly, what we put in place to monitor how hard students are working. This is not about being mean to students. The big part of this is actually helping them to help them massive, massive issue across all subjects, not just maths. So fluency tests are one way of doing this. So how can you put a twist on it to hold students to account? Well, firstly, fluency tests, I've talked about what they are. They're basically just a test with lots of skills in it. It's nothing glamorous. How are the questions chosen? Basically, from starter map weaknesses, from stuff you know that they just don't know, from an assessment they've just done, and you can pull out all the questions that are wrong. That's your fluency test. Why are they important? Well, the examiner reports tell us they're important all the time, but we know that 50% of foundation is AO1, 40% of higher is AO1. That appears throughout the assessment in all different questions, even the AO2 free questions. It's there for our fluency, it's knowledge, it's the most important part before we can address exam style questions. So that's kind of what the format looks like that I share with schools. Schools adapt this, it's not prescriptive, so I'll share modules with schools and they'll take ownership of them and make them look slightly different, shorter, longer, however they want them to. And a basic model, it doesn't look basic, but it is basic. But the test has to be developed, so it's not about pulling a randomised test off the internet. There are loads and loads and loads of fluency tests online. But is that test suitable for your class? So we've done a lot of training with departments on how to write a fluency test for your class, bespoke for your class. Preparing students, and this is where the accountability comes in. Give them a chance to succeed. So give them the model solutions of that first fluency test and saying in a week's time you're going to have this fluency test but with different numbers. Go away and practice it. Come and see me if you're definitely not sure on the question. But because I'm giving you the fluency questions and the mark scheme, I'm going to put a benchmark of 80% on it. That's what I want you to get. And if you don't get it, then we're going to put some time in outside of lesson time to work on that. So it's not saying, oh, you're going to be in detention. It's not about that. It's actually about saying, if you don't get 80%, I'll help you. But really, you are saying, I'm giving you detention. It's code. Carrying out fluency tests, all these logistics, just simple things, really. But the marking of it is incredibly important. I don't think we should be marking classwork, exercise books. I mean, I always say this to departments. I think students should mark their work in class. That's instant feedback. We shouldn't be trawling back for exercise books, put stickers in, and marking questions which they did 3 or 4 weeks ago, unless we purposely get them to reflect on what we've written. And I see a lot of feedback in books, which I know is there to fit a policy. So actually, let's just throw that out the window and say, well, if we mark a purposeful task, like a fluency test, I'll know my class inside out. I don't want them self-assessing it, wasting time in lessons, and I don't want them peer assessing it. I want them to know what they've done. So it's going back to basics a little bit. And then I would just choose a question, a high-stakes question for that student that they got wrong, model it, write some question next to it, get them to complete it, to close that gap. Not closing 6 gaps, but closing 1 gap, a purposeful gap. And I trialled this before I sort of talked to schools about it at the Hurlingham Academy with a weak year 10 group. When I first did this, it was a nightmare because I wrote a test on stuff I thought they should know. Well, it was a bit of an eye-opener. Because they didn't know a lot. So it was really going back to the drawing board, and that's where I adjusted that model, that's where I wrote the solution to them and helped them to do well at it, because it's not their fault, they've just forgotten it. Or for whatever reason, they hadn't been taught it, whatever the reasons are. Then setting homework, I mean, if you really want to go to town on this, you go to Home to Maths Fair and you pick those questions from that fluency test, which you think are high stakes, and set them homework tasks on it. That's the next level. I've seen that started in a school recently at Sedgehill, one of our new schools, and that's going to work really well there. And then review it. So the next week or the next fortnight, give them the exact same test, but with different numbers and twists. So from test 1 to test 10, it won't feel like you're changing it much, but if you compare 1 and 10, they'll look completely different in terms of difficulty. And also keeping a high benchmark in there of whatever it is, 80%, whatever you want them to achieve, but coming back to them about what they're doing week to week to work on it. So that's fluency tests. And the next one is pre-C mock. So a lot of schools have trialled walkie-talkie mocks, and I'll be honest, I think initially I was not a big fan of walkie-talkie mocks, because the question is, what is the accountability for students? what is a follow-up? We work through questions all the time with students. So do I want to sit in front of 100 students in a hall and talk at them for an hour and a half? It's probably not the best use of my time. They'll probably switch off. So we put a little bit of a twist on this model. I don't think students at this point in time should be hammered with unseen papers until June. They have enough official mock papers. So this can be chucked in as a little bit of a method to help confidence, but really hold them to account. So I've got this model again, it's a bit of a repeat because it's an easy thing to do on PowerPoint. A lot of this is logistical. So I'm just going to focus on a few of the steps which are the most crucial steps in this process. Every step is crucial, without it, it will fall flat in space. And it's quite hard work to set up. Choose paper, set the dates, change the numbers on the paper you're going to review with them, model the answers with students thoroughly. But the key thing here is that teachers create a benchmark. So teachers need to, for each class, they will identify effectively the questions are going to work for the students in detail. And these are questions that students should be able to do at this point. And it's not content that hasn't been delivered yet. This is very important with higher tier students, because there'll still be stuff that they haven't been taught. You don't want to just walk through a question with them and get them to memorise it. And then the number of marks and model, basically that becomes a benchmark. So if I've got a weaker higher group, say, like a really tricky group at the moment, I might only walk through 40 marks out of 80 with them. Actually, I might model it with them in class. I'll specifically tell them, these are 40 marks which I think you can do at the moment. And that becomes a benchmark. Actually, that equates to nearly a grade 7 at the moment. So you can tell them that. They might be sitting on a grade 4 at the moment. So it's quite powerful in terms of confidence, telling them this is what you can actually do. Heads of department need to check that benchmark, to check it's challenging enough, or to check it's not too challenging. Because the whole point of this is a follow-up, and if you're setting them up to fail, it's going to do worse for confidence than what you plan to do. Talking about it with senior leaders. So talk about it in department. Email the benchmarks to your head teacher, for example, and say, when you see that student from set 2, just say, right, I know your benchmark's 45 out of 80. Have you been revising? Have you been practicing? Delivering the pre-seen lesson, really, really structured. Again, telling them what the benchmark is, really transparent with them about what they're going to do. And don't allow students to attempt the questions first. This is about you being the expert, so you're modelling it for them. You might do a few targeting questions, but it's not about drawing stuff out of them that you think that they should know, because they're probably just quite rusty on this. Model it for them. And then students might model solutions in their script, and share the benchmark and grade that this relates to with them. So everybody's going to get to this benchmark, at least, and that's the important bit, at least. And revision, then give them a week or 2 weeks, preferably. I think 2 weeks is better. It does give them more time to forget and puts the onus back on them to actually revise. Encourage them to come and talk to the teachers about trying to improve your independent learning. What I really want to know is, what are they going to do with the 40 marks which you haven't gone through with them? Are they going to work on them independently? Will they come to you and say, I've had a go at this, is it right? I mean, that would be brilliant if students were doing that. And then the actual assessment, exam conditions, it's official. But being very clear with them that they're probably going to get a higher mark than they would do if you hadn't modelled it with them. But the reason for that process is hopefully clear for them. And then follow-up, definitely celebrate those who met the benchmark. I mean, I love rank orders, so I'd be putting it up on the wall. I'd be saying exactly who met the benchmark and what mark they got. And then I'd be having a follow-up action plan in place for those students who didn't meet the benchmark. And that'll be very revealing. It could be students from your set one, your most bright students, who you're aiming to get a grade 7 or 8 or 9, but actually what you're picking up there is a little bit of laziness or something which is going on which hasn't enabled them to revise. So it can be powerful in lots of different ways. I'm very, very aware it's a very clinical process. They're not going to see those questions. That's not the paper they're doing. That's not the point of the process. The point is you're preparing them for revision, preparing them how to revise, and you're putting it back on them, a bit of accountability. It's something which, if I go into schools now and they're just doing unseen papers every single fortnight, I'm not sure what that's really doing to help the students. That for me is the biggest thing at the moment that I'd want schools to be trying. And the other one is common questions, which we know really form like a really key part of that grade 4 or 5 boundaries. So this is kind of a strategic thing for schools to be using. It really does set the bar high for foundation students. And we know that they find these questions difficult, but effectively if they can start to cope with these questions, then hopefully the stuff underneath it will become a bit more easy, you know, it'll seem okay. And preparing them up with higher tier students really is saying to them, look, if you want to get a grade 6+, which if you're on a higher tier, that's what they should be doing, it's not right to get a grade 5, then if we actually just flip forward to actually grade boundaries for these questions, what's really interesting is that a grade 7 student on the Excel cohort last year got nearly 80% of those common questions correct. So it's actually sharing that with them and saying, look, if you want to get a grade 7, you need to be getting roughly this percentage on these papers. And you know, you can form these common question papers on Emporium, AQA produced them as well. And they're like 20-minute papers, quite nice, low stakes for them. But they do that. So they effectively model to higher tier students that bread and butter stuff, which to be honest at the moment they're not secure on. We took in data from a common mock we did in November, and I analysed the common question data. And students on the higher tier are not where they should be in terms of common questions. So we take like a student like this. This is really revealing. So these are 4 of our students from United Learning. And it tells you what the target grade is and what tier of entry they were entered into in November. And if we just went on the like warm up, we would start to make decisions about tier of entry. But actually, if we start to look at how they performed in the common questions, we can then start to give students a chance to stay on the higher or to move from foundation to higher. So for example, the student, I guess, at the top for me, I would be questioning why that student was on foundation. But from a very cold point of view, it's just data. And there's maybe lots of reasons, you know, confidence, but really that student there is performing at the moment on a grade 4 in November, and we know where they get to in June, that student could have a chance to get a grade 6 or grade 7. And we've become very cautious and put lots of students kind of into foundation, but we need to be careful that they're not still capable of a higher tier. So it's quite a data-based strategy, but it can be useful to look at. And if you're that interested in it, you can Google that common question, there's loads of blogs about it and stuff. Yeah. Homework. The last one, just coming back to Colin, finally. Well, what does it actually look like? So, I mean, just put your hand up if you use, like, Hexie Maps, because then I'll know if I can be specific. Great, okay, I'll be really specific then. So I went into 2 of our schools and I picked a borderline group, and I say borderline, it's a weak set 2 higher group, who at the moment probably sitting on a grade 4 and not doing very well, and I looked to see how they're engaging in homework. And this is the first class. And I ranked it in terms of what looks like the best kind of outcome down to the worst. And then this is another group here. So probably if we look at it, we can agree that that looks better than that. Yeah, so that looks better than that. There's a delay. But actually when you dig deep into the Hexamath data, it's really, really powerful. So this clearly says that class are just not engaged in homework at all. And actually in a conversation with the teacher, they thought that they were kind of doing okay on it. And actually, no, when you pull this up and you have a look at it, half the class are not even doing it. This one as well, we can actually dig a bit deeper in this. How hard are the students actually working? So I'm going to pick the student who is 4th down on that list on the left. Got 100%, didn't watch the video, spent 7 minutes on it. On the face of it, that student looks amazing, they're getting 100%, but they're definitely not being challenged because they're not having a task which has challenged them. Okay, so then we could say maybe it's just a revision task. But really, what is the purpose of the homework? And it's to set them up for good independent work. So we should be setting the task where the video is essential. It's something that they need to revise. So here I've been speaking to the teacher about, well, is it the right task that they're doing? And then I go over to the students on the right here, and 4th up from the bottom, For me, I would celebrate that student out of the whole class. 80% tried it twice, watched the video 2.5 times, properly like wanting to get it. For me, I'd be celebrating that student. I'd have this up on my board and I'd say, but that's working really hard on something you don't know. And I'd say to that student, fourth one down there, if that's you, maybe try to choose a task that you don't know. Okay, go do a fix at 5 or whatever. So just coming back to homework, accountability, head to mouth, like it's an amazing tool if it's used correctly. So that's it. I just wanted to sort of give you some strategies which we're using at the moment to get it kind of push stuff back on the student because we're all working so hard and really to help them succeed. Thanks so much for listening and coming all his way after work.